Today I want to talk to you about motivations. Motivations for doing a hard thing. Something very difficult, which is removing sinful patterns of behavior from our lives. Now, you would think that taking away things that are harmful would be a kind of an easy thing. You'd want to get rid of them. And so, therefore, you'd be more likely than not to get busy with the work and, just get going and get rid of as much as you can. Well, let's just take something simple like overeating. How many people of us here are struggling with overeating? Don't raise your hands. That's okay. You might have a real desire to have a healthy body and honor God in that way. And you know it's right. And you know you ought to. But just getting to the gym or staying away from the refrigerator is not an easy thing. There needs to be something more that motivates you than simply knowing it's the right thing to do. Well, I believe that this particular chapter is written to keep people in the fight, to keep them motivated to do what they know they should do, peeling off those old behaviors that no longer control us. At least they have no power over us, but we let them control us many times. And begin to experience the adding on of things that bring a lot of blessing into our lives. We need motivation. We need somebody to encourage us. And I believe that this particular chapter does that for us. Starting with verse 1, it says to us, "Therefore we are, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us." It's a wonderful image for us. We all understand what races are like. Kids are kind of struggling with that idea and kind of struggling with how that fits into a concept of just my life and how I live it. But we start with some things like this to give us handles that, well, I understand that. I don't understand this, but you tell me that this is like this, and so I can see similarities. I can see patterns that fit both sides, and then I begin to understand this part, which I hadn't understood before. So these are very helpful metaphors that give us an idea of what he's talking about. And so he says, first of all, just like in a race, there are people who are watching the race, so are people watching ours. It may not be saying directly that there are people in heaven who are looking directly at everything that you're doing, but in a figurative way of speaking, they are watching. They are concerned. They are very much wanting us to do well. It is a cloud of witnesses, which he has been talking about in the previous chapter. They're not witnesses in the sense that they're watching, they're witnessing what's happening, but they're witnesses in the sense that they have seen what God has been able to do in their own lives, and they can stand up as witnesses to the faithfulness of God. And they can stand up as witnesses to say that it's worth it, that you can do this, that it is not an impossibility. It doesn't take special people. Takes ordinary people, and God can work in our hearts and lives to change us. They are witnesses to that fact. And since having read chapter 11, I hope that you have read it sometime. We didn't start here in our study of Ephesians, but you'll remember that chapter 11 is the hall of fame of people of faith. Call it a hall of fame because each one of them has a different aspect of faith that really worked deeply in their lives. God used their faith to help them to change and become more and more like him and made him pleased with them. So he says, these people are witnessing to us, saying that continue on, don't give up. I know what it's like when it's hard. In fact, the second half of the list of the people mentioned in chapter 11 are those who were persecuted, those that were martyred for their faith, all dying that they may, not seeing that which they were hoping for, but knowing that it was something beyond the grave for them, that they would be together with God So we're surrounded by them. They're with us in the sense that they were in the fight that we now are presently in as well. And so he says, since that's the truth, well then let's get busy. Let's throw off everything that hinders. Now, Charlotte had a lot of clothes on, and those were definitely going to be hindrances if she was going to run a race. It seemed almost silly that she should be having a vest and a heavy coat and big boots. But at the same time, the behaviors that we allow in our lives, that we give place to continually, if we really look at them through the eyes of Christ, they would be as silly as the things that she was wearing. Now, maybe even not just silly, but morally unacceptable. Why is it that we're giving place to these things which are intended to harm us, when we could actually add things to our lives that would bless us and that would glorify God and complete the work that he had started in us through Jesus Christ? So we need to cast off those things that are bad. So that's really what the study is that we've been working on in Ephesians chapter 4, about taking off stuff and putting on other things. So this links this passage to that passage very easily. So let us run then with perseverance the race marked out for us. Perseverance is something that is absolutely necessary in a long distance race. I like watching the Olympics, and I like watching people run. I like watching people who run fast and short, right? You know, the 100 meter run. They come out of the gates like blazing, and just like you can barely see them for the blur of their legs. And they speed past us, and all you see is just the effects of their going by. You know, they're so fast. I love that. But they cannot run a marathon because they expend all of their energy in 100 meters, and that's it. That's not the way our lives are lived. It isn't 100 meters for us. It's a lifelong marathon. We run and we run and we run. And there will be times, I've been told by people who run marathons, there are times in the whole of the race where you're aching, you're hurting so badly, you'd rather die than take another footstep because it's hard. But then there are barriers that people break through in the midst of this running this long race that give them extra strength, give them extra wind and speed and endurance. And it comes to them if they continue on knowing that they have to get to the very end. And so this is what the writer of Hebrews is saying to these people. You need to endure. You need not to collapse. You need to stay strong even when things get really, really hard. So you need to run that race with perseverance. And make sure you run the race that is actually marked out for you. Can you imagine people running in all directions and hoping to get to the finish line faster because they're doing shortcuts and things like that? That's not a race. It's not a fair race. It's not. We never do that. We always do it according to the rules. At least most of us do. There are some. I heard on the marathon once, I don't know whether it was New York Marathon or Boston, where there was somebody who was waiting in the sidelines, a side street, and came in and joined the race at the end. What was he thinking? That is not how you win a race. And that is not how we run the race either. We can't find shortcuts, find things that excuse us from suffering. We must run the race that is marked for us. Your race will not be like mine. In some ways, I think that's a wonderful thing that it's not like mine. And yet, at the same time, I would want your race to be something like mine, because God has been faithful to me. And through things that he's brought into my life, he has made himself much more dear, much more precious to me, and given me things that could not have come any other way. So I run the race that he's marked out for me, and I don't look to you to see what mine should be like. I look to him and say, Lord, what is it you're doing in me? You were very tempted to say, well, Lord, why can't I have what that person has? They seem to have it so well. There's no injuries, there's no sicknesses, there's nobody in their family dying. Why is it that they run smoothly? Why is it that it seems like they have plenty of money, plenty of houses, all the things that seem to be desirable in life? But I hurt myself when I look at another person, because God's plan for me, the race run out for me, is not the same as it is for that person. So I cannot do that. I need to trust him for the race that he's given to me. And so he tells us that we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. They are witnesses to the faith of God. If you go back to the Hebrews chapter 11, just one page probably for you in your Bible. In verse 5, we see, by faith Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. This is what God is developing in our hearts and lives. He's developing our faith because that is what pleases him. And when we are pulling residual sin out of our lives and crucifying it, that pleases him because we are exhibiting faith when he tells us that it should no longer have mastery over us, and that that is a terrible thing to be doing. It does not fit those who belong, who are children of God. And as I express my faith in what he has told me about myself in terms of being a child of God, and I begin peeling those things away, I please him. It is what he wants. And this is the way it was with these people in chapter 11 as well. They were witnesses of how God gives his righteousness to those who place their faith in him. We read in verse 7, by faith Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family, and by his faith he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. Faith is what makes us able to receive God's righteousness through Jesus Christ. Abraham's story is one that's developed in great fullness, and I'll not go through that with you for lack of time. But Abraham was a man, his story is told in greater detail than most others. And we see him starting out just with an act of faith of leaving his family and going to a land that he did not know about. Isn't that what we do when we come to faith in Christ? He calls us to a whole different kind of life. And we just step out in faith saying, Lord, I don't know what this is going to mean for me. But I trust that you are indeed the God of the universe. And I trust in Jesus as the expression of your love. And if you love me that much, and if he has indeed paid for my sin, and he has a desire for me to follow him in his footsteps, I will go. I don't know what it will cost me. I don't know how it will go. But like Abraham, we trust him and we follow him and he blesses us. It doesn't mean that we won't be carrying a cross. Jesus promised that to those who followed him, that they would indeed suffer. But these people in this particular chapter suffered. Yes, they did. And they are willing and able to say to us, it's worth it. It is worth it all. Don't ever give up, because I found that even in the midst of the suffering, that God was present and that he is worthy of my faithfulness. There is a hymn that I happen to love. It's in your hymnal. Don't turn there, because it's really a shortened version of the hymn. The hymn has actually 11 verses. Can you imagine us singing 11 verses? Oh my goodness, we would be falling by the wayside. But if you think about what these verses say, they are so full of inspiration. I'm going to help you a little bit with the poetry, all right? Because in poetry, sometimes the poet shifts phrases backwards so that he would end up with a word that sounds the same as the line before, okay? That's the freedom they have as poets. But think about what he is telling us. He is saying, Jesus, I want your name to be blessed for all the saints who are now resting from their labors, who by faith before the world confessed your name. Now he says it this way: for all the saints who from their labors rest, who thee by faith before the world confessed, thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Thou wast their rock, their fortress, and their might. Thou, Lord, their captain in the well-fought fight. thou in the darkness drear, there one true light. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here's some new verses. For the apostles, glorious company, who bearing forth the cross o'er land and sea, shook all the mighty world, we sing to thee. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the evangelists, by whose blessed word, like fourfold streams, the garden of the Lord is fair and fruitful, be thy name adored. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the martyrs, who with rapture kindled eye saw the bright crown descending from the sky, and seeing it, grasped it. Thee we glorify. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, may thy soldiers, faithful and true and bold, fight as the saints who nobly fought of old, and win with them the victor's crown of gold. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, blessed communion, fellowship divine. We, feebly struggling, they in glory shine. All are one in thee, for all are thine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And when the strife is fierce and the warfare is long, steals on the ear a brave, a distant triumph song. And hearts are brave again. Arms are strong. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The golden evening brightens in the west. Soon, soon to faithful warriors comes their rest. Sweet is the calm of paradise, the blessed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But lo, there breaks a more and glorious day. The saints triumphant rise in bright array. The King of glory passes on his way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. From earth's wide bounds, from ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearl streams in this countless host, and singing Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, say it with me, Alleluia, Alleluia. Do you understand? We're not alone. We're not alone in this. People have gone through this before us and have been faithful, and they stand by us in their prayers. Who knows what goes on in heaven? And I suspect they voice their concerns for us. He's telling us, have courage. Have courage. We have these examples. Well, that's great stuff. But it isn't as great as it gets. It gets as great as it gets when you think about the Lord Jesus. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down on the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So the example of Jesus in fighting against sin isn't that he was peeling off his sin, but that he was setting his face like flint toward the cross, desiring greatly that this could be accomplished so that he could set us free. But on the road to the cross, there were those that would trip him up, that would cut him down, that would distract him with sin, that would do anything they could to keep him from getting there. He is the one who gives us faith by the Holy Spirit. He is the one who completes the work in us. Look unto Jesus, because if he's given you life, he will also complete the work and bring you home again. If God is for us, who can be against us? Take courage. He is the one who complete that work. He is the one who suffered the loss of all things for the joy that was set before him. He looked at the suffering that was to come. He looked at the joy that would be accomplished in his death. The joy of people from every tribe and nation throughout the whole world coming to be part of his kingdom. They would be sons and daughters to him, brothers and sisters to him. What in the world is the suffering of the cross? He despised it as if it were not worthy of consideration. That doesn't mean he didn't suffer. It doesn't mean that he didn't agonize as the day grew close. But when it came to choices, when it came to choices whether I will give in to this fear, this suffering, this horror in terms of the wrath of God being poured on me, and then comparing it to that which what I will enjoy in being the part of this family that I am redeeming by my blood. There is no consideration. Lord, not my will, but yours be done. You see, look to him as the pioneer and the completer of your faith. Look to him as an example. He suffered greatly. Is there any suffering that we endure that can compare to him? He says, push through it. Push through it. That's where he goes now. Verse 4, your struggle against sin. In your struggle against sin, you've not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. That's pretty high stakes, isn't it? It sort of sets it out as something that seems of immense priority. It isn't something that, you know, I think the pastor's been relating to us about this. Sounds interesting. Sounds like maybe my life might improve if I follow his instructions and example. But this is far greater than that. It's far greater than that. Jesus suffered in the shedding of his blood. Are you willing? Are you willing to be like him? Are you willing to carry your cross? Are you willing to suffer that you might peel off those sins that have become habitual to you and to me? He says, and you've forgotten a word. He quotes from the Old Testament. You've forgotten the word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. Two things, one positive, one negative. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline. That's not a positive thing, but it's sort of like saying it doesn't matter too much. You know, I think that Christians should be better people. They should try to strive to be like Christ. But I'm not about to do anything that costs a lot. I'm not about going to lose my friends. Let me tell you about a neighbor. A neighbor across the street who just recently came to the Lord. The moment that her friends found out that she had accepted Jesus as her Savior, they began confronting her. What are you doing? You're crazy. She told me about a time she was in the giant shop parking lot, and she saw a friend, wanted to greet them. That friend came over to her and said, you are an idiot for following Jesus. And their friends, one by one by one, have rejected her outright. They will not talk to her. They think she has lost her mind. And she says, I still love Jesus. I still love Jesus. He has not rejected me. And I will follow him. And it seems like day after day, more and more and more things go wrong. As if Satan is trying to make an example of somebody who would come out of his bondage and have the gall to say, I'm going to follow Jesus. And it's like pounding and pounding and pounding. She does not take lightly, as I begin to explain to her, this is part of God's work. Jesus went through these things. Believers go through these things. Believers are martyred for their faith. Why should we think that we will not suffer? Why should we think that it shouldn't be something that we would embrace? Because this world is not a friend of God. This world hates God. So don't take his discipline lightly. Don't think of it as unimportant. And he goes on to talk about these sufferings as being part of his discipline. He says, also, you've forgotten the word of encouragement. And that second word is, don't lose heart when he rebukes you. It isn't because he has lost love for you. It is not because you have failed and you are beyond help. He says, because the Lord disciplines those that he loves. That he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. Yeah, he does. Every son should be punished because we're wicked people. And we need to be disciplined that we would turn away from our sins. Because he loves us, he doesn't let it go. We see all around us parents who are afraid to say no to their kids. And we see the results in the kids' lives. So, he says, if God is doing this, this is how you should respond. Think about this. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. He's treating you like his children. And a father always disciplines his sons. For what son is not disciplined by his father? If you're not disciplined, and everyone does undergo discipline, well, then you're illegitimate children if you're not being disciplined by God. Moreover, think about this. We have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it. Maybe not at the time we were disciplined, but later on, if we saw the fruit of that discipline, we look back and we say, thanks, Dad. Thanks, Mom. Thanks for not letting me do those things. Thanks for telling me that those things are dangerous. Thanks for letting me know that the problem is in my heart and that I need to turn my heart over to Jesus. And so if we respected them, then how much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and live? He's worthy of much more respect, isn't he? Our fathers disciplined us for a while as they thought best. And so God disciplined us for our good. In contrast to what we thought was best, God does for us what is best. He disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. God should be praised for his discipline. But he doesn't just let us live any way that we want. Now, he says, granted, no discipline seems pleasant when it's being endured, but painful. But later on, he says, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. So we need to be thankful, and we need to be patient and allow those things to develop us into his image and be glad, even though it's painful presently. But whatever, he says, therefore strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees and make level paths for your feet, so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. If God is working this way presently on your life, if he loves you so much that he is training you with all the different hardships that you endure in your life, why then respond to it. He says, strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees. Exercise. Allow him to train you. Fully throw yourselves into it, because you know that it's going to produce good fruit. It just makes good sense. And also, by the way, while you're at it, all this exercising, you might want to remove some things that are going to cause you to become lame. Some of the sins in your lives that are going to trip you up. It's time to deal with them and time to get help from God to, by his grace, remove them. This is what God is doing. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, for doing this for us. Thank you for the example of those who have gone before. That's not all the motivations in this chapter. I think probably we'll finish it up next time, since it's 12 o'clock now. But we have plenty to chew on, don't we? Plenty to think about. If God is indeed working in this way in our hearts, and he's telling us to get rid of lying, get rid of this, don't get involved in anything sexually impure, all of these things, well, then we just need to start saying, Lord, by your grace, help me to overcome this. I want to start today. I want to change and become what you want me to be. And I'm willing to be in it for the long run. I'm willing to persevere. I'm willing to fall and to get back up again and keep trying. And I trust you that you know what you're doing in the long run. And what you're doing is maybe painful, but it is also fruitful. And I trust that. I want to express my faith as those in chapter 11 did, those who have gone before me and said, it is worth it. Let's pray together. Father, thank you. Thank you that we are not left alone. We have those that have gone before us who give us encouragement, cheer us on. Their lives are examples that give us good things to emulate and to trust in, because you were faithful to them, you'll be faithful to us. Thank you for the Lord Jesus, who suffered greatly in order that we might become part of his family. Thank you that what he's begun, he will finish. And we can rest in that. And so, Lord, we surrender ourselves anew to you today, asking that you would change us. One thing at a time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.